it's beginning to seem as if the people may once more be asked for their view on the highly charged issue of abortion. If Fine Gael is back in power, there will be a citizens' convention on the issue and the party's TDs would have a free vote on any resulting legislation, the Taoiseach said last week. Then yesterday, the High Court in Northern Ireland issued what's been described as a landmark judgment on abortion, which, while it won't have any direct impact on this side of the border, is sure to lead to further public debate. Mark Coughlin reports.
It's an issue that has changed the lives of many and touched the lives of many more. Yesterday at the Belfast High Court, a major judgment was issued in relation to the availability of abortion services.
Well, effectively, the argument was whether the prohibition of having an abortion in the context of fatal fetal abnormality or in the context of where a woman had been raped was contrary to, ultimately, the European Convention on Human Rights.
The wording used was concise and controversial.
In the case of a fatal fetal abnormality, there is no life to protect. When the fetus leaves the womb, it cannot survive independently. It is doomed. There is nothing to weigh in the balance. There is no human life to protect.
It's that final line that has resonated with both sides of the debate.
It is stark in terms of its assessment of Northern Ireland law, which is a different jurisdiction. It is, of course, which is relevant for Ireland in particular, Southern Ireland, it's interpreting the European Convention on Human Rights, which, of course, all courts would have to do. But it starkly says that the prohibition of having an abortion in the circumstance of fatal fetal abnormality and rape violates Article 8 of the European Convention on Human Rights, which is the respect for privacy.
Bishops have said they're shocked and disturbed by the judgment. Already the Northern Irish Attorney General has said they're considering appealing. As both North and South are common law jurisdictions and the case relates to the European Convention, it may yet be cited as case law this side of the border.
This judgment is really staking new ground in some respects, because the European Court itself, the European Court of Human Rights, has firmly stayed away from resolving in major terms the issue of circumstances which abortion may be permissible. So it's an interpretation, some might say an interpretation too far.
It comes following weeks of discussion brewing about the topic in the Republic.
I think the landmark decision in Northern Ireland really will put extra pressure, if you like, on the politicians in the Republic to deal with this issue in whatever way.
In the last 2 weeks, Minister James Reilly said he supported the idea of repealing the Eighth Amendment of the Constitution. That amendment equates the life of the unborn with the life of the mother.
There was slight sense of panic, I think, in Fine Gael when that happened. But really, it's been a useful exercise for the party in some ways. Certainly speaking to some Fine Gael people inside Leinster House, they do make the point that politicians in recent years have very often been behind public thinking on a variety of issues. So they do think it would be a good thing to have this issue discussed.
Labour and smaller left-wing parties have also been pushing their long-running campaigns in the wake of the marriage referendum. But the Taoiseach, who was not in the slightest bit irked by Minister Reilly's pronouncements, has ruled out a referendum this side of the election. He said he will put the issue to a constitutional convention, a sort of citizens' forum.
Dr. Reilly is perfectly entitled to his personal views. My issue was that it would be impossible to have an early referendum on an issue that is as complex as this without people understanding fully what's involved in it.
In some ways, it's a kicking to touch. It's pushing this issue well past the next election. But on the other hand, it's also attempting, I think, to replicate what went on with the marriage referendum, taking a contentious issue out of the political sphere, taking it very, very far away from politicians and the pressures that they're under as they're facing into an election.
It seems many roads are again leading to somewhere we've been before, a referendum on abortion. The question is one needed? And if so, when it might be?
Mark Coughlin reporting, and I'm joined now in studio by two politicians, both independents with a interest in this area, Deputy Claire Daly and Senator Ronan Mullen. Ronan Mullen, do you accept that it's now becoming inevitable that the Eighth Amendment is going to be revisited in some form?
I don't know. I don't think it is inevitable. I think there's always a tendency in the media, I suppose, and there are certain elite groups who are very anxious to dismantle the basic equality of all human beings that
really,
the Eighth Amendment provided.
Groups?
But I think that there are political classes that get a big hearing in the media whenever there's a development. But what we're not hearing, for example, and I think this is the sad thing about the judge's decision up north, was he appeared to be ignorant of the biology. I mean, it was really quite chilling, the language of there is no life to protect. I know, and I have brought families into Leinster House who would be deeply hurt by that, because they think that there's a perception that babies in that case are either dead already or are in some kind of pain. I know a family, for example, where their baby lived for 17 minutes. They cherished every minute. They made memories. Mm. And they are terrified. But it is more than just a choice, because they believe that why should the law say that their child matters less than any other disabled child? And they believe that if you take away legal and social protection for those children, that families like those don't have a future. There's no talk about perinatal hospices, yes. The supports that we need so much.
We'll talk about that again in a moment, but you're talking about elite groups that you claim are influencing the debate. But opinion poll after opinion poll has shown a majority in favour of abortion in limited circumstances. Fatal fetal abnormality is one, case of race, rape and incest is another.
Well, actually, what you saw in the most recent opinion poll was that the figures were coming down, and that, in fact, all of the figures, when you looked at it circumstance by circumstance, as I recall, came in under 50%. But I think people realise that, you know, if you look at those who clamour for abortion in Ireland and in other countries, they always talk about hard cases. But in fact, what they will all admit, including Claire, is that they want much more.
Okay.
Across the Western world, it's always about chipping away.
Okay,
and
well
there is no experience of limited abortion.
Okay, well, can I ask Claire to
well,
respond?
I'm not in favour of limited abortion. I'm in favour of women making a decision for themselves in consultation with their doctors, and I think a majority of people would have that view. We know that both in terms of Irish people's attitudes, but also pressure from the international community, that it is now an unstoppable force that there will be a repeal of the Eighth Amendment, because we are simply in violation of even minimum human rights standards in that regard. Because Roland made the point about prenatal life. In international human rights law and acknowledgement, the right to life begins at birth. And even in those instances where there may be a valid interest in terms of prenatal care, that right does not interfere with a woman's human rights.
Okay,
and that's
but
what
isn't it very clear that while Irish people might be in favour of extending abortion in certain circumstances, they're not in favour of doing away with any limitations on it. And I'll quote an Amnesty International poll taken by Red Sea in July. 81% favoured abortion in cases of rape or incest. Only 45% favoured it in unlimited cases.
It's not only 45%. That was the biggest component group.
It's
but I think the point is that only 14% of people believe that there shouldn't be abortion in any circumstances. And I think what we've seen evolved is that people themselves may have different attitudes on this issue, and that is absolutely their right. But what people don't have is a right to enforce that viewpoint on other people, because the scenario outlined by Ronan, the very sad case of a much-wanted pregnancy which only lasted for 17 minutes, I think anybody watching the programme, their hearts would go out to those people, and they would hope that that was the best decision for that family. And nobody is altering that decision. What we're talking about is providing for the other families who can't go through with that.
Let me tell you about another little child who I know personally, called Louise. Her mother was told that the child would not survive. Mm. And the child is now six, enjoys ballet and so on. The truth is that doctors can never be sure how long a child is going to live for. You can generally say not very long in some cases,
yeah.
But even there can be surprises.
We've heard terrible stories of people who've had to go to England to have abortions in cases like this, to bring the body of their dead child home in the boot of their car. In order to bring it home for burial. That surely can't be right.
And we can do better for those families. I think it's a tragedy, and I know of cases where people came home from England not realising that there could have been things like perinatal hospice services. What do I mean by that? We've never really discussed it. Our government never talks about it. I'm talking about a set of supports.
A lot of people don't want to go through with that.
But you see, this is about what culture. If you say that you can take away that child's life because that child is severely disabled.
David, this is going to be incredibly distressing.
How is that fair? No, we all have to be caring for everybody.
finish your point, Ronan.
I think it's fair that we would have that families who get that distressing news, for example, would not have to sit in maternity wards or in for meetings with families who have a healthy baby. We haven't begun to talk about how we could support those families.
We have to be very
clear.
Terminology in this situation. You mentioned the issue of disability earlier. This is not about disability. There are many parents who were given a diagnosis of a fatal fetal abnormality who would have wished for anything for that child to have been disabled. The point is for them to continue that pregnancy knowing that there was no chance of a life at the end of it, people congratulating them on their much-wanted arrival. The stress of that is cruel, degrading, inhumane torture. It's not me saying that. All of the international human rights organisations say that.
You never talk about the possible support.
This is an international human rights issue, and we're violating all of those rights. And a majority of Irish citizens actually do believe in abortion in circumstances which allow that. It's like turning off a life support machine. That's a tragic decision for people in those diagnoses, and they should be making that decision surrounded by family and friends. All of the masters of the maternity hospitals believe that that treatment should be available to them in
Ireland.
And
what about the cases where the doctors get it wrong and the child dies because the law allows it, who could have survived? I know families who didn't have abortions in England. They were up on the list twice.
I'm talking about scenarios.
The reason they didn't was because our law had abortion.
I want to get back to the wider question, which is whether we're going to have another...
Just by the way, with all due respect, you do normally encourage us to challenge each other, particularly if there's false stuff being said. So I'm not trying to be in any way impolite here, but...
Perish the thought. But we are dealing with the wider question, which is about whether we will have another amendment. If the constitutional convention that the Taoiseach is talking about meets, if there is a middle way proposed, isn't it more than likely that both of you will oppose whatever is proposed?
Well, I'm in favour of a repeal of the Eighth Amendment. I think the
United
Nations...
But are you in favour of repealing it only in limited circumstances?
No, I'm in favour of removing it from the Constitution. I think it's completely inappropriate that a woman's health and body is a subject for a Constitution. I mean, we have a ludicrous scenario here, David, whereby Irish women have a right to an abortion in our Constitution, but we have to have it outside the country. That's crass hypocrisy.
Sorry, the question I was trying to reach is... Any alternative to the Eighth Amendment is likely to have some restriction on abortion, which you would oppose.
There doesn't need to be an alternative. This is a health matter like other health matters. There doesn't have to be legislation.
So you wouldn't favour any controls?
Well, look, I believe that it should be medically supervised, as indeed other medical practices. I think countries like Canada, it's worked very successfully regulating the practice medically under medical boards. Other countries have chosen legislation. Yeah. The first thing and the important thing, which the United Nations and other human rights bodies have, we must take it out of the Constitution first.
United Nations, contrary to what Claire has said, by the way, does talk about the right of the child to, the Convention on the Rights of the Child to protection before birth. But, you know, this talk about there being a middle ground is also part of the political game. In fact, pro-abortion activists always vote for whatever limited bit of abortion is on offer. They bank it and they come back for more. We have the middle ground in Ireland, David, which has worked very well, which is that women's lives are always protected and the doctors always focused on protecting two lives. That is why we were always there or thereabouts the best in the world in terms of maternal care for women in pregnancy.
That is the middle ground, and
it has worked for us.
Well, it hasn't. It has meant 162,000 Irish women have had to leave this country to access what is routine medical
and watching practice who are alive
to protect
because
your hypocrisy.
Didn't have
thank
abortion
you both.
In Ireland.
Thank you both.
If they were in England, they would have
both.
Died.
Thank you both. That is a discussion that we will be hearing a lot more of. But Claire and Ronan, thank you both for joining us.